Welcome, friends. Welcome back to the kitchen. Welcome back to Sunday morning in the old cookbook show. Today, we're going to do another recipe out of this Mrs. Bliss Practical Cookbook. And a few weeks ago, we did a pie recipe out of this book, and a lot of people commented that one recipe down was another pie that they'd really love to see me make. And so we're going to make it today, and it is called Marlboro Pie. Now, at its core, this is a single crust apple custard pie flavored with some brandy. Let's give it a go. The first instruction, it's quite lyrical, actually, very poetic. The first instruction is to pare and grate fair sweet apples. So I've got four apples. I think I'm going to use probably two or three apples. I'm not really sure exactly. The recipe doesn't tell you how much filling to make for a pie shell. It just says for every two apples, add this amount of other things. So it's really up to you as the maker of the pie. And also it takes into account all apples aren't the same size. And depending on where you live and which fair sweet apples you've chosen, you're going to get a different amount. So I'm going to use, I think, about a cup and a half of grated apple, see where that gets me, and then adjust all of the other amounts to match. Now, this recipe book was published in 1855, and so it uses a mishmash of different measuring. Some of the measurements are given in what we would consider standard measures, like cups and spoons. And some, like this recipe, use teacups and also wine glasses or gills. And those are a little bit harder to convert because not everybody agrees on what a teacupful or a wine glass was in this time period. So if you're someone who needs exact measurements down to, you know, the milliliter, these recipe books probably aren't for you. You have to make a lot of decisions along the way and just sort of make things up almost because we don't really know what they were looking for in 1855. Definitively, we don't really know what they were looking for. So I've got three apples here and I'm going to say that's all I'm going to use. And for this amount of apple, I think I've got the right amount of other stuff out on the counter already. So I'm going to go with the next ingredient, which is three eggs. And so I'm just supposed to crack these eggs in and then whip them up. So give those a quick whip. And to that, I'm supposed to add the finest sugar. So in goes the finest sugar. And some melted butter. So I'm going to put the apple in there now. There we go. Get it all. And give that a whisk. Next ingredient is lemon zest. And so I'm going to zest this lemon in, and then I'm supposed to juice in, seems like about 3/4 of a lemon. And there's always a lot of discussion in the comment section on YouTube about how big a lemon was in this time period. And everybody seems to think that today's lemons are larger and juicier than they were in the 1850s or even up until, you know, 1930s. And I'm not sure if that's true. I'm not sure if it's not true. I know a lot of times when I put lemon in, it seems too lemony, so maybe it is true. I'm going to say that's enough zest. It seems like an awful lot. Now, we'll juice in this lemon, and I'm just going to squeeze it through my fingers to catch any seeds. If you want to use a juicer or a squeezer or a reamer, go right ahead. I think this will get us where we need to be. Now, the next ingredient is brandy. Now, I don't have any brandy. What I have is cognac. Brandy and cognac are essentially the same thing. Brandy is the larger category, and you can call it brandy wherever you make it on the planet. Cognac is exactly the same thing, but it is made in a specific region of France called cognac, and only brandy made in cognac can be called cognac. And a lot of people would argue that there is a huge difference in quality. I'm not going to say that's the case. There are some incredible brandies out there, and there are some awful, 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 just awful cognacs. So I'm going to put that in, and we'll give this all a mix. Now, the last ingredient is some milk. So Just get that measured out here, see where we are. The mixture seems really soupy already at this point, so I'm not sure how this is gonna go. And I've also got one of our all butter pie crusts ready to go here. So I'll mix in the milk. And we'll pour this into the pie shell. And this is a 9-inch shallow pie shell. I think this was the most common size in this time period. And I think we've almost hit the right amount. Now there's no temperature given in the cookbook. It tells me a time of 30 minutes, but no temperature. This is also the type of pie that I would really prefer to par bake or blind bake the shell before putting the custard in. But I've got the oven preheated. I'm trying to shoot for like 400, 425. I've got my pizza stone in, and I find that having a pizza stone in with this type of pie really helps to set that bottom crust so it's not soggy. We'll see how it works out. I will get forks. Okay.
One fork for you. It has a very visually interesting texture.
I was going to say unappealing. I was going to say visually unappealing.
But that's not what's important.
No. Well, no. For the most part. Okay. Not my thing.
Was it the lemon? Is there lemon in it?
There is lemon in it.
Okay.
So it's lemon.
I taste lemon. That's what I taste. I taste lemon.
Brandy. I taste a lot of brandy.
Oh, yes.
So that might be Mr. Overpour. I may have overpoured.
So you may not be doing this recipe justice.
Well.
Because an overpour on brandy would also perhaps give it that texture of being a little too liquidy. It's not a nice solid custard.
Well, one of the problems I had was that this is in teacups and wine glasses where the measurement's given. And so when I look online, I was able to find four competing amounts that people said was a wine glass and a teacup.
Yeah.
And we've even got, you know, I looked at our teacups because I thought, oh, I'll just use a teacup. I'll just be a smartass. We've got like a dozen different sizes of teacups.
Yes.
So I may have screwed this up, but I'm going to tell you, I don't think even if I got it right, I would be on board with that. That doesn't invite me to go and sit and eat more on the couch later tonight while I watch sumo.
Noted.
So.
Noted. I'll add some whipped cream and maybe that'll help.
Whipped cream might help. And I would, if you want to try this pie, I would definitely throw the crust in and par bake it or blind bake it before you put the custard in. Because even putting it on the pizza stone didn't help with the bottom crust. It's still, I mean, it's not soggy, but it's not fantastic. So there you have 1855 Marlboro pie. Thanks for stopping by. See you again soon.